You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hey there, hi there, ho there. We're as happy as can be because you're back with Introduction to Planetary Science and Astronomy, Physics 195 at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm Bruce Betts from the Planetary Society, and today we're talking about exoplanets, planets around other stars, and we'll be talking a little later in the program to Debra Fischer, from professor at Yale University, one of the top leading planet hunters, exoplanet hunters in the world. So that'll be fun to get some insights from her. So be thinking if you have questions. You can ask questions of me during the rest of the class via email, via phone, via all those other ways. So exoplanets, which again, just a planet around a star that's not the sun, is quite the big developing field. In fact, just about a week ago, there was the announcement of the Kepler mission of the confirmation of the first ever roughly Earth-sized planet inside the habitable zone around another star, so the area where liquid water could conceptually exist on the surface. Now we know very little more about it. We'll talk about that more later on and take a look at a video from Kepler. I want to mention that it is quite the timing, and in fact, exoplanet exploration history, or it's mostly discovery, is not that old. In just a little over 20 years ago, there were no known planets around other stars, no known exoplanets. And now, a mere 20 years later-ish, there are now, as of today, depending on whose count, but basically a little more than 1,700 exoplanets that have been confirmed around other stars, around over more than 1,000 stars. There over 400 of those are multi-planet systems, so we've discovered more than one planet in the star system. And there are another more than 2,000 candidates from the Kepler mission still to be confirmed. And they won't all be, but some large fraction of those 2,000 are exoplanets. So it really is a burgeoning field of science, and it's the case where studying just our solar system for the entire history of humanity, we were limited to essentially one laboratory, one set of results of an experiment of planetary formation. Whereas now we're starting to see more and more and more star systems, and it's teaching us about how star systems form, how they exist now, and eventually we hope to find true Earth-like planets and maybe someday life out there. We'll talk about that more profound aspect in a couple lectures. But today we're going to talk about how the heck do you find a planet around a star that is many light years away. And we will talk about the various techniques used to do that. And at the end of the lecture, we will hopefully have time to talk about solar system formation. How's the solar system get put together? So let's start our exoplanet journey by getting a little perspective, a little introduction. Let's go ahead and put the first picture up. You can just put it up behind me. It's a flavor picture. Artist's conception of a hot Jupiter, so a planet, a Jupiter-sized planet found very close to its parent star. Turns out we found a lot of those. That was one of the many surprises that have come from studying other star systems and finding planetary systems that look very different than ours. So one of my themes, I mean, keep coming back to, is just to impress upon you the diversity of planets and of systems we've found, much more coming in the future. All right, let's take a look at the next image full screen. I'm going to use a few of these images, so I want to orient you to them. These were produced for the Planetary Society by Darren Ragazine, who is now Dr. Darren Ragazine at Harvard Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics. And part of what he does is study exoplanets. And we've got these diagrams to give you an idea of what planetary systems, other ones, look like. Again, my theme, there's a great diversity. This is our solar system. So with the Sun and then Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. Oh, I just can't, we can't be green. We can't be green. No green. Oh, sorry. There, soothing red. Okay, Jupiter, Saturn. So basically in all the images you'll see of other systems, you're gonna see color-coded, so the size of this central star will represent something about the size of the star, and the color of the star. And the colors of the planets will represent their approximate sizes, with Jupiter class being red, Saturn class being yellow, and Uranus and Neptune classes being blue. Of course, this being our solar system, that's what they actually are. And then there's some gradations in between. The one thing that will change on the chart, important to notice, is the scale bar, which for this system is 30 AU, so the Earth, the Sun, Neptune distance is basically 30 AU, 30 times the Earth-Sun distance. But that's what will vary because we'd see planets really close to their stars and really far away from their stars. So there you go. That's what we'll be looking for when I pop up a bunch more of these images. Next image, although the technical details are maybe off, maybe the circle's a little bigger than it should be, maybe we now are finding out to 1,000 light years from the Sun, the point that I want to make here is shown here, which is, this is the Milky Way galaxy, 100,000 light years across. We are only mostly, with a few exceptions, only finding planets within a small bubble around the Sun. Now, when I say small, well, it's huge, even compared to our huge solar system. But it's small compared to the size of the galaxy. So we're looking at most things being found within 1,000 light years rather than relative to 100,000 light years across the galaxy, because that's what we can see easily. Now, the first way you might think of finding exoplanets is the way that almost never happens, but has happened a few times, which is actually seeing the planet. Imagine trying to see a small bug in front of a spotlight. Well, it's kind of hard because the spotlight kind of blinds you to seeing the small bug. So you have to get clever in your techniques. But if you can get a big enough planet far enough away from its parent star and try to block the light from the parent star, we have done a limited amount of direct imaging of exoplanets, including direct imaging discovery. Let's take a look at some of those. Next image, full screen. This is a Hubble Space Telescope image. So what we're looking at here is the central star, which would be here, but they've blacked it out. They just put a dot there to show the location. The star Fomalhaut, and they've blocked that out. And then you've got a bunch of this noise, which is just where you're stretching the heck out of this data, contrast stretching it. You're seeing the noise rather than signal in a lot of it. Some things are real, like this background star, but where we're looking is right in that little square, which they've blown up and put two different years on it, 2004, 2006, and sure enough, we see that speck move from there to there, and they have just enough signal. They have enough signal to feel they've got a real detection of a planet that they can watch over the years, and so yeah. Let's look at the next image. It'll show you how far out that planet is. So now, in this solar system of Fomalhaut, the scale bar is now 120 AU, and that's the distance basically to this planet, or that's the ballpark. So out beyond the Kuiper belt equivalent in our solar system, out where we see objects in our solar system, but nothing as large. This is a Jupiter-sized planet or larger, and that's what allowed us to see it. Let's look at the next image and look at a couple more examples. This is a star and planet, ?55 AU out. Well, this is actually probably a brown dwarf. Now, we're back to a terminology game. We talked last week about planet, how the definitions can change. Well, brown dwarf as opposed to a planet, also a little fuzzy, although there's some physics behind where the break is usually drawn, which is around 13 Jupiter masses. So if you've got something up to 13 Jupiter masses, we're going to call it a planet. You got something more than 13 Jupiter masses, we're going to call it a brown dwarf, unless it's fired up nuclear fusion inside it and become a full-blown star, in which case it's a star. So technically, this was a discovery of a brown dwarf rather than a planet. Let's take a look at the next image, and then we'll switch techniques. But one more direct imaging technique. This is from the European Southern Observatory Very Large Telescope, or VLT. And here we have the fun name star, GQ Loopy. And GQ Loopy has a planetary neighbor that they were actually able to image. But again, big planets, far from their parent stars, right geometry, then maybe you can do direct imaging. But that's not where most of our discoveries have come from. Up until the last very few years, and we'll look at a graph later that'll show this, most of the discoveries were using a technique called radial velocity. So the two big techniques, we've taken a look at direct imaging. I rate that as a small technique, just meaning a small in numbers. There's some more exotic techniques we'll look at a little later in the class for discovering exoplanets. But the two big ones are radial velocity and transit method. First, we're going to talk radial velocity, done typically with ground-based telescopes. And then we'll talk the transit method, which is what Kepler uses. And when we get through that, we'll take a look at more statistics of discovery and what's been found in terms of planets. But first, I want you to understand radial velocity, which was the first technique to have lots of success and represented most of our discoveries for the first 15 years or more of planet discovery. But it also still can do things. Each of these techniques has limitations and has positives. I mean, direct imaging is great because you directly image it, but you really need a really giant thing really far from the parent star and kind of relatively close in space. For radial velocity, you have one set of constraints and one set of benefits, and for radial transit, you have a different set, and we'll talk about those. The basic concept of radial velocity is that when you have a planet going around a star, and we'll talk more about the details of this, but let me give you the basic concept. Planet going around star, just like we talked about with Pluto and Charon, they rotate around a barycenter, still typically inside for big planets or stars. Often the barycenter is inside the star, but it still means the star is wobbling. It's orbiting, even if it's just orbiting kind of like this around a point inside of it. And that wobble is what we detect. And in the case of radial velocity, we're radial indicating along our line of sight, we're actually looking at wobble back and forth. We're looking at this type of motion. Now, it's actually going around like this, but what we're sensitive to, as we'll see in a moment, using Doppler effect, is going back and forth like this. So it's looking at those radial velocity changes, basically because you've got a planet that is tugging on its parent star, that is gravitationally bound, and the bigger planets in close are what we preferentially detect because they're the ones that are going to have the biggest gravitational wobble effect on the parent star. And it gets tougher as you get farther out, although you can still detect planets. Big planets are easier, closer planets are easier. So that's kind of the weakness of the system. The good news is if you can do this, if you get it, then you get some idea of mass, although even that's uncertain because as we'll pay attention as we talk the details, but basically, if this is the plane of our solar systems, we detect, in this case, where the plane of the system is kind of like this, but there's no moving forward or backwards, no radial velocity if it's up and if it's perpendicular to our line of sight. Anyway, we'll get into more details, but I want to put you where we're starting from. Let's take a look at some questions first, and then we'll dig into the details of radial velocity detection. I read, from Katie Gilliam, I read that only two exoplanets have been directly observed using Earth-based telescopes. Is that correct, and which ones are they? From Earth-based, It's certainly about the right number, and I do not know which ones they are. One is probably what we just looked at from the European Southern Observatory. And there may be a small number more than that, but it is a very small number. And I can't tell you which one it is other than the GQ loopy one that we were looking at. Now, another one from Kryn. There was a rumor that eventually Jupiter would become a very small star. Is this true or just an urban myth? Yeth? Noth. It's an urban myth. No, Jupiter would need a heck of a lot more mass. Even though it's so huge, it still would need many times more. Even at 13 solar masses, you still don't form a star. You go to brown dwarf. So it would need a lot more mass. I'm sorry, 13 Jupiter masses. Obviously, if you do 13 solar masses, you can make a star, no problem. Jupiter is adding very, very little new material. So no, not going to become a star. And from Christopher Kane, what is the smallest exoplanet that we have ever been able to discover to date? Right around the size of Earth, I'm not actually sure. We'll see the video a little later on about one that's just a little bit larger than the Earth. Certainly around Earth size is the smallest, but that's really been the focus of Kepler and even radial velocity trying to improve it, is to look for more of those small ones, but they're harder to detect than big ones, whether you're doing transit or radial velocity methods. All right, let's look at the next image. And this is to give you an idea what you do radial velocity with. This is the one of the telescopes at Lick Observatory. I'm trying to remember. I think it's about a 3.5 meter telescope. Debra Fischer, who we'll be talking to later on, and colleagues, including Jeff Marcy, have done a lot of radial velocity measurements using the Lick Observatory telescope. They've also used the larger ones like Keck Observatory, which is 10-meter telescopes. Others use everything in between. And even, let's look at the next image. For closer, brighter stars, maybe we'll ask Debra about this. This is Debra here and her colleague, Julian. And they are on, this is the back end, electronics on a 1.5 meter telescope, which is huge for an amateur, but really small for a professional. But they're able to look, particularly for the Alpha Centauri system and some of the other closer systems study, they get enough brightness, enough light that they can use the smaller telescope. And the advantage is they get more nights on it. All right, now to understand radial velocity, one needs to understand that we're using Doppler shift, which I think I've alluded to in the class. And I'm looking for videos that gave you some visual on Doppler shift. And the one I'm going to show had a flying saucer and a cow. So I figured, I found it. So let's take a look at a quick video from Ask an Astronomer and Caltech Infrared Processing Group, IPAC. A little bit about what is redshift, and then I'll fill in. So go ahead and run that video.
To understand what a cosmic redshift is, think about sound. Sound travels in a wave. You hear the engine of an airplane because the waves travel through the air to your ear. If the airplane is moving, the sound waves in front of it are compressed, creating a higher frequency sound. The sound waves behind it stretch out, creating a lower frequency sound. As the airplane passes you, you will hear the familiar Doppler shift. Light also travels in waves, and a similar thing happens to these waves. Light waves are able to compress and stretch, thereby changing their frequency or color. Blue light has shorter wavelengths than red light. When an object in space moves towards us, its light waves are compressed into higher frequencies or shorter wavelengths, and hence we say that the light is blue shifted. When an object moves away from us, its light waves are stretched into lower frequencies or longer wavelengths, and we say that the light is red shifted. So,
poor cow. They'll probably bring him back. Anyway, that's the concept, and we talked at length in the second lecture about electromagnetic spectrum, about the different wavelengths. And so if you go to shorter wavelengths, you go to higher frequencies. That's what happens when something is coming towards you. If you go to longer wavelengths, the waves stretch out, as shown by the spacecraft taking the cow away, then you are seeing a shift to longer wavelengths to shorter frequencies. Yeah, there we go. Let's take a look at the next image and see how we apply that with planets to find exoplanets. Let's look at that full screen. So, in the radio, the concept is that if you've got a star, exoplanet going around it, that as the exoplanet goes around, the host star is also going in its own little orbit. It may be, this is probably kind of exaggerated, but it's orbiting some place in space, and then massively not to scale is Earth over here. As the star is coming around this way, it's actually coming towards the Earth. And so that is causing a going to shorter wavelengths, which is called a blue shift. So imagine something in the middle of the spectrum like green light, and if you are moving towards it, then it may shift to blue light, and the green when it's going away, when it's on this side of the orbit moving away, then it shifts to red light. Now, just because it's called red shift and blue shift, kind of for that type of situation, doesn't mean it necessarily involves red light or blue light. But how the heck do we apply this? Let's look at the next image. This is all wonderful theoretically, but we got to figure out how things shift. Well, this, let's look at the unshifted at the top here, is an example spectrum, what you might see from looking at a spectrum of a star. And notice there are black lines. Those are absorption lines, like we've talked about in other contexts in the class, where certain atoms or molecules get excited, and as the light passes through them, they absorb certain wavelengths of light. They like certain wavelengths of light. So there are various lines that we recognize from as being common in stars, things related to hydrogen or helium or sodium, whatever. We have certain lines that we recognize where they should be in a spectrum. Then if we see it redshifted, we see like this line moved over like this, or this doublet moved over, line moved over. It's moving this direction towards longer wavelength, which wherever it starts, we will always use the term redshift. And is similarly, when the star is coming at us, then this line now moves that way. It gets blue shifted. Blue shifted means going to a shorter wavelength. And so by measuring the amount of shift, how much it goes over, we can get an idea of velocity. Now this is a, and from the velocity we get an idea of basically the wobble of the star, and that implies how big the planet is and how what the period of that wobble is gives us what orbit that planet is in. So that's how it works. Let's take a look at the next image. So this is just to give you an example of some of the things found using that method. This is the star with the name HD189733. Now this is a Jupiter-sized planet super close to its parent star, because now the scale bar is 0.031 AU. This is a Jupiter-sized planet way, way inside where the orbit of Mercury would be in our solar system. Now how do you find these beasts, or what's the... Let's look at the data. Let's look at the next image, some sample data. Try to, again, put the pieces together. So here on this axis, we have radial velocity in meters per second. So when the star is moving one direction, you see it going that way from zero. When it's moving the other direction, the other shift, it goes that way. And this is phase, which is basically from zero to one is one orbit of the planet. And what you see is you see a blue shifting as its star is coming towards you, a red shift as it's going away from you. You get this nice sine wave kind of thing. The dots are real data with error bars, and then the curve is a fitting to the data in this particularly nice one. And by looking at from one consistent place in this orbital period, this sine wave, you can get an idea of the period. So this planet here has only a 2.6 day period. It is whipping around its parent star, hot, ugly, fast moving, type planet. So really different than anything we have in our solar system. All right, let me take some questions. And from Jonah Lay. So the only reason why known exoplanets tend to be large and orbit close to their star is because they're easier to find as a result of the greater wobble they create. Yes, mostly yes. So yeah, you've hit on something very, very important, which is when we look at, and I'll show you some statistics for exoplanets in a few minutes. When we look at statistics, you're going to see a lot of stuff that's found up close and that's big. And that is, in part, a sampling effect, because the easy things to find are big and up close. Now, on the other hand, we didn't really know we'd find any big and up close. So the fact that we're finding them is fascinating. And so there are a lot more than would have been predicted 20 years ago. But yes, it's a sampling effect. And the other thing is, with radial velocity or transit, if you're looking at something that's farther out, you need to take longer. So if you're at something actually at a Jupiter orbit, for one orbit, it's 5 years, 5 Earth years. And so usually, in either method, to really feel warm and fuzzy about your measurement, you like to repeat that measurement ideally 3 times. That means it takes you 15 years to confirm Jupiter, even though you got plenty of mass, just because it's taken so long. So yes, we very much preferentially find stuff close in because there's a bigger tug in transit method. It blocks out more of the starlight, and because there's a shorter period, so we can confirm it faster. So keep that in mind. Excellent point as we look at statistics and data. Okay, let's look at some other planet systems. Mostly the point here is there's a lot of variability. Next image. Full screen. So this, now we have a 0.0471 AU scale bar. We've got a Saturn-sized planet, again, ridiculously close to its parent star. Next image shows you, this is data from one of the first systems found to have multiple planets. Now there are lots of them. This is from 55 Cancri, where you actually pull out the other planets, and you again see the same type of orbital phase. And in this case, you have periods measured in days. And notice the velocities that we're looking at. We're looking at tens of meters per second. Now that's important because when we go to find an Earth-sized planet farther out, you need to get down to less than a meter, down to tens of centimeters per second of the star moving. The amount of movement we're talking in the star. Notice that's a really small velocity that we're detecting. We're looking for really small changes in wavelength shifts. All right, let's look at the next image so we get through this before we talk to Debra. I'll go ahead and move on. Next image, full screen. Again, just some sample systems. This is the same one, 55 Cancri, now with multiple planets filled in. So your graphs look a lot more complicated when they actually include the effects of multiple planets. But you can, if you have enough data, you can extract what's the stuff. This is, 5.8 AU? So this is roughly in a Jupiter orbit out here. And you've got a very tight inner solar system, so a lot of variability. Next image. This is a visualization, at least how based upon data from a very few years ago. Have different looks at this is our solar system, and on the same scale, 55 Cancri. So, kind of similar looking ish, except for that missing that nice Earth planet. Next image, Gliese 581, and here another system with lots of planets. This is a 0.22 AU now, though. So, this is all crammed in much tighter, and notice you got a pretty darn elliptical orbit for being fairly close in as well. Let's look at the next image. Again, emphasizing diversity here, not forcing you to learn any particular single part of it. So 0.2 AU scale bar, and we have variable, different kinds of stars. We'll talk about that at length next week. For now, just know there are different temperature, different size stars. We have different, just different. There's just a lot of different going on. Next image. And we even have this kind of weirdo. We got 0.44 AU, and we've got an exceedingly elliptical orbit going super close to the parent star. On this scale, it looks like it's hitting the parent star. That's only because of the way the the star is represented, not actual, but still very, very different than our solar system in terms of being this close in. We have weird, highly elliptical things like Sedna, but they're really, really far out. Next image, and this is just a subset of data. We'll look at some more eccentricity data later. But I just, again, want to show we got diversity. So this is with an early set of radial velocity planets plotted. This is semi-major axis of the orbit in logarithmic scale. So this is 1 AU. This would be Earth out here. This is 0.1, so a tenth well inside Mercury. And you've got stuff way inside, close to the parent stars. And then this is orbital eccentricity. And if we have a chance, we'll talk about that at the end of the class. But bottom line, this is a circular orbit. This is a really, really skinny ellipse out here. And just, again, you see a lot of variability on this axis, a lot of variability on this axis. Next image, just some terminology. So for referring to exoplanets and conceptually, and this ties to one of the questions that actually I saw pop up earlier from someone, which was, if you have a Jupiter, is there any way you have that be a solid body that, you know, humans might live on? We don't think so. We don't think you can build something that big without it being mostly gaseous, having enough material in a solar system. At least we don't think so. This is Earth size, this is Jupiter size, and then you have this, which is Neptune size, usually what it's called. And there you may have a gaseous body, or we think you could generate a rockier body that actually at least approached that size. Certainly the two Earth sizes you might have as rocky bodies. So we're still learning, and we'll get more information as time goes on. All right, let's talk transits for a few minutes, and then we'll connect to Debra Fischer. So Debra Fischer plays in both worlds, but she comes out of the radial velocity technique world. Okay, so transit. Now the concept is, instead of looking at the wobble of the star, we still are assuming we can't see the planet, but what we can see in this case is the drop in light if the planet passes in front of the parent star. Now, right off, you see there's a limitation here. You got planets, and if they're all mostly in a plane, like in our solar system, you're not going to see the planet block out the star if this is tilted even slightly. I mean, it can be slightly, but not very much. Because you got to get, here's your star, here's your planet, you got to get the planet going in front of the star. And by the way, the planet's a lot smaller. I happen to have two planet stars that are similar in size. But imagine small, and you have to get it lined up so it goes in front, as opposed to if it's like in this situation, you never ever see it go in front. So here is your random space fact for the certificate of achievement of completion of this class is as follows. The probability of just having in any given randomly distributed orbital situation that you would actually have these things line up at some point. So a Kepler-type spacecraft, a transit observer, would ever see Earth pass in front of the Sun if you were off somewhere else. It's only a probability of like 1 in 210.47% that on randomly distributed planes you would actually see Earth. So on the one hand, it means your technique is missing a whole lot because transit really depends on being pretty lined up. On the other hand, if you look at enough stars, you can start building up a lot of statistics. And on the third hand, the fact that we're seeing so many planets from Kepler is telling us there are really a lot of planets out there because we're relying on getting lucky with the plane of the star. Let's look at some images to emphasize how this works. Let's look at the first picture full screen. So here's the concept. You stare at this star over time, and you look at how bright it is. And the brightness goes along like this. Well, then if a planet... panic. Okay. Hang on a second. Maybe Debra thinks we're going now. Well, let's hold off. All right. Sorry, we got the Skype set up for Debra. Let me send her a message. Well, maybe I won't. This is all very real time, don't you think? Okay. Sorry for the delay, everyone. So if this passes in front of the star, then our intensity is going to drop. It's going to go down, and then as the planet stays in front of the star, it stays at this intensity, and then as the planet goes off the star, the intensity comes back up. But this looks like you're blocking out half the light based upon this scale. In reality, as you can see, even this is probably a really good case. You still get a tiny drop in brightness. So Kepler's been in, analogies have been made of detecting a flea passing in front of a headlight. You're really looking for tiny drops in intensity. So look at the next image. And here you can see some of the variability. So if you've got a big star, and the same size planet passes in front of a big star, medium star, little star, you see different relative drops because it's blocking out a different percentage of the light. If you see if here we have the same size stars, but you get different size planets, you see different characteristics of the way the light happens there. So basically this is saying you can extract information about the planet from how much light drop you get, and how often it repeats gives you an idea of, or tells you the orbital period of the planet if you're detecting one planet. Now let's look at the next image. We're going to talk about this in detail next week. But this is just showing there are a whole lot of different types of stars that come in all sorts of different sizes and intensities. And so related to the last graph, we see variations based upon that. Next image. So this is another example with real data where you had a planet passing in front of a very small star as opposed to a planet passing in front of a very large star. Obviously, you see a bigger percentage drop in the pass in front of the small star than you do in this pass, which they've blown up here, but you can still extract it from the data. So the big example in this is Kepler. Let's look at the next image. This is an artist's conception of Kepler. So Kepler is a space telescope launched in 2009 that has been in, and this is obviously all conceptual, looking for planets in front of stars, totally not scale. And let's look at the next image. So Kepler is on the one hand super simple and on the other hand not. It's basically designed to stare at the same part of the sky. It's got one instrument, which is a visible telescope. And in some ways, it is the most boring mission ever. And yet, in other ways, it's giving us some of the most exciting results ever. The way it's boring is the way you do this science is you observe the same thing over and 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 over, and over hundreds of thousands of times over multiple years and look for those dips in light. And so that's all it's doing. It just stares the same part of the sky, part of the constellation Cygnus, and it just observes it over and over and over. And for more than 150,000 stars, they actually look for these drops in light. And it's from that that they find planets. Now, this is also was done originally, or not originally, but it was done by Corot. ESA's spacecraft did this. Kepler's been more sensitive. As you'll see, Kepler has found now the majority of planets that have been found around other stars. And there are future missions from NASA and from ESA and thinking about that will utilize this same technique. So we'll come back in a few minutes and we'll take a look at some of the detail, the results, and the statistics of what's been found in these thousands of planets. But one thing to note is that any given planet find, you want to confirm. So particularly any one drop in light, you can't trust, particularly because stars can be variable. And stars vary in how bright they are. So just because the star dims, it may be the star variability. If you see it dim every 103 days over and over again, then you got a pretty good idea you got a planet. And so that's what you look like. Let's see if I can get one quick question in from Katie Gilliam. Is it possible to locate an exoplanet by observing the brightness of the parent star over a period of time to see if it dims when the planet could cross it? Yes, that's exactly what transit is. Sorry if that was delayed in getting through. you just described the transit method. So what we're going to look at now is, while we get Debra Fischer on the video Skype line, you're going to take a look at probably two videos. First, from Spitzer Space Telescope, of how one looks at, tries to detect, learn about the atmospheres once you know there's a planet there, and it's kind of an inverse transit. You look for the planet disappearing behind the star. And then we get to Kepler's big discovery in the last week or so ago, which is the first Earth-sized planet in a habitable zone. So let's go ahead and run those videos. We'll get Debra on the line. Think of your questions, and here we go.
NASA's Spitzer Space Telescope wasn't designed to be an exoplanet super sleuth, but it's proving to be an amazing infrared detective tool. Spitzer has split open the light from two alien worlds, two planets outside of our solar system. The resulting data, called spectra, reveal clues about their atmospheres.
We wanted to measure the spectrum of the planet because that tells us what molecules are present in the planet's atmosphere.
Three different teams basically found the first real spectra of a planet around a different star. And that's a pretty big deal.
Grillmeyer, Swain, and a third team headed by Dr. Jeremy Richardson studied two planets, HD 209458b and HD 189733b, two hot Jupiters, or gas giants, that orbit close to their suns, 300 to 900 trillion miles from Earth.
Well, you've heard the analogy that looking at a planet around another star is kind of like seeing a firefly next to a searchlight. It's a very, very faint object next to something extremely bright. So how do you look at that? In order to take this spectrum, what we have to do is we have to let the planet be eclipsed by its star so we can't see the planet anymore, and then subtract the spectra that were taken inside of eclipse from the spectra that were taken outside of eclipse, and then we're left with what the planet contributed.
Some astronomers predicted there would have been water, and to their surprise, they found no hint of it in either atmosphere. That could mean the water is hiding under a blanket of high clouds.
If the clouds are at high elevation, they may just obscure the atmosphere of the planet, the lower atmosphere, where the strong water signature might exist. I think it's premature to say.
Richardson's team, however, did spot something else, silicates.
There was a feature that we saw in the spectrum that is probably due to silicate emission, and silicates are like molecules that have silicon and oxygen and typically some other metal in them. And what that means is that there's likely a cloud that's pretty high in the atmosphere that could be made of these silicate grains, basically dust grains.
Spitzer astronomers hope to study the two planets more in the future and to use this technique on a handful of other transiting planets that orbit stars outside of our solar system.
I think this will ultimately be one of the most important legacies of the Spitzer Space Telescope, unanticipated as it was before launch. I think it will become extremely important in the future.
This is a stepping stone to eventually studying signs of life on worlds where life could exist, the habitable worlds which we're hoping to discover in the near future.
A step, perhaps, to answer the question, is there another Earth out there?
NASA's Kepler mission has discovered the first Earth-sized planet orbiting in the habitable zone of a star outside our solar system. The newly discovered planet is called Kepler-186f and is about 10% larger than Earth.
Kepler-186f is the first validated Earth-sized planet in the habitable zone of its star. It's the outermost of five planets to orbit a star that is smaller and cooler than the Sun. This planet orbits its star every 130 days. And so this places it in the habitable zone, where it's in a region where it could have liquid water on its surface.
Kepler-186f resides in the Kepler-186 system, about 500 light-years from Earth in the constellation Cygnus.
This planet, Kepler-186f, orbits a star that's cooler and dimmer than the Sun. So while we may have found a planet that's the same size as Earth and receives a similar amount of energy to what Earth receives, it orbits a very different star. So perhaps instead of an Earth twin, we've discovered an Earth cousin.
On the surface of Kepler-186f, the brightness of its star at high noon is only as bright as our sun appears to us about an hour before sunset. Scientists believe Kepler-186f is likely to be a rocky world, but are unable to confirm its mass and density.
This is one of the big milestones that we've been looking for in our attempts to find out if there are places just like home and if there's life out there. One of the big steps is to say, is there somewhere that looks, to all intents and purposes, like Earth? Well, we don't know just yet, but we know that there are places that at least look similar.
Managed by NASA's Ames Research Center, the Kepler mission collected this data using a space-based telescope to search one part of the galaxy for potentially habitable planets.
Hello and welcome back. We have got Dr. Debra Fischer, professor at Yale University, on the line. And I apparently have generated some feedback, audio feedback, so sorry about that. Professor Fischer is one of the leaders of exoplanet hunting, particularly with the radial velocity method. A lot of those dots you saw on graphs came from the work of her and her colleagues. And so I just want to welcome Debra, and how are you doing?
Thanks, Professor Betts. It's really nice to be there.
Good to see you. So I guess we'll start with what the video we just watched. So what do you think of the new Kepler announcement of the Earth-sized planet habitable zone?
It's incredibly exciting. We've been, hoping that Kepler would get to the point where it could detect Earth analogs. And so it's fantastic and bittersweet to see that it made this discovery. It just gives you the sense that if only Kepler's reaction wheels had lasted for another year or two, we really would have been, mining this incredible, rich population of Earth-like planets. And of course, was the main mission of the Kepler mission. The main goal was to figure out if there are other worlds like our own. It looks pretty clear to me that, worlds like our own are pretty common.
Now, I know you've got all sorts of things going. The Planetary Society has been involved with some of them. And you've worked on some of the largest telescopes in the world, but also I know one of your projects that I showed a picture of you at the telescope a few minutes ago is at the Cerro Tololo Inter-American Observatory in Chile, looking at nearby stars, including the closest stars at Alpha Centauri. And how is it that you're able to use a comparatively small telescope like a 1.5 meter and do such careful looks for exoplanets?
Yeah, I think our precision on the Alpha Centauri project is exceptionally good. These are incredibly bright stars, and we've been working hard since about 2007 to say, what can we do to make our instrument more stable? And one of the key breakthroughs was to switch from using the old spectrographs where the star just shines onto the slit of the instrument to using spectrographs that are fed with fiber optic cables. So there's a whole new field of physics that's opened up called photonics. And we're working with some of our colleagues in applied physics to figure out how we can inject the star into the spectrograph and get a really stable illumination. With a little 1.5 meter telescope, as you note, the disadvantage is the small size, but the advantage is that there are not many projects that you can use a small telescope for. And so that makes these telescopes available to us for an incredible amount of time. We've been observing Alpha Sen for between 100 to 200 nights a year collecting data on the system. And you can't do that with a telescope like Keck, a 10 meter telescope.
Now, we posted an update on the website from you a couple weeks ago at planetary.org about your results so far with Alpha Centauri. And it's kind of interesting. Maybe you can describe, including the announced planet from the other group and where you ended up on that at the moment, and what the future holds for Alpha Centauri.
Yeah. So this, of course, I started this project with Greg Laughlin, who's a friend of mine at UC Santa Cruz, and we realized that Alpha Centauri was the system to look for low-mass planets because it's a binary star system. We understand its orbit very well. The orbit is aligned, so it's almost close to being edge-on, and that means any planets that are in that star system are going to be orbiting nearly edge-on, so we get the full radial velocity signal from the star. The stars are old, the stars are metal-rich, so they have plenty of material to make planets when they were forming. And so we launched this intense survey, and our colleagues and competitors, but great friends, in Geneva, Switzerland, were also looking at this star system with their telescope, HARPS. So there was a competition that was going on, and I think I didn't realize until 2012 that knowing that we had launched this intense survey with the little 1.5 meter telescope, they were ramping up the number of observations that they were getting. So they had a huge advantage. They had a big lead in terms of having an instrument that was producing really high precision measurements. And in December of 2012, I got a phone call from the Swiss team saying, you know, we think we found a planet around Alpha Centauri B. And, you know, I have to say my heart just absolutely sunk at that moment. But I was, on the other hand, really excited because my view was that if there's one planet there, we see, you know, stars that make one planet make multiple planets. And this particular planet was orbiting once around Alpha Centauri B every 3.24 days. And that would make the temperature of the on the surface of that planet incredibly hot, between 500 and 1,000 degrees. So it's not a good place for life as we know it, but in some sense it was a marker, right? A flag saying that, hey, this is a star system that can make planets, and if we keep looking, we may find more habitable worlds that are a little further out from the star. So we redoubled our efforts, and in fact, we started collaborating. Xavier de Musquez, I was served on his PhD thesis committee in 2012. So when they told me about their discovery, they also invited me to be on the thesis committee for this young researcher. He's now on the East Coast at Harvard, which I understand is also a fairly good institution like Yale.
Did we mention Debra was at Yale?
That's right. And there's no rivalry whatsoever. So he's come down several times and we've chatted about the discovery, and I gave him our data that we had collected so that he could try and find out if it was syncing up with their data. And we became a little bit concerned, I think, and we decided to launch a collaborative survey. So in May of almost exactly a year ago, my graduate student, Magic Gare, went down to Cerro Tololo, and Xavier de Musque was on the La Silla telescope. These are, you know, in the Andes Mountains, these are adjacent peaks. And so we can look over and spy and, you know, see at least the telescope dome at La Silla. And we had a coordinated effort. I knew when he had time, and thanks to the Planetary Society, I was able to then double the amount of time that we would have put into it. And, you know, I knew that their instrument, their telescope is bigger. We had to work twice as hard, and we really did. And so, but what happened is that as these two stars orbit each other, you know, Alpha Centauri A and B, double star system with a planet going around the smaller of those two stars, the projected orbit of the stars was causing them to come closer together. So it was becoming harder and harder for us to look at B and not get contamination from the other star A or vice versa. So when we analyzed our data, we saw a very clear signature of this contamination. And we worked real hard to try and do the optimal analysis and from the data that we have. I have to say, you know, in 2012, very clean data set. In 2013, the data set was more contaminated, but we just don't see evidence for that 3.24-day signal. And so I'm trying to figure out what that means. And I realize also that I said that the two stars were getting closer. They are now at their closest approach. And by about 2015 and 2016, they'll start moving apart again. And so that gives us time to further improve our instrument and our analysis techniques so that as these stars start separating, we'll be able to go back and follow up on this again. Even today, though, I have to say I was meeting with one of my undergrads who's working on some new data mining machine learning techniques for trying to improve our analysis of the data that we have in hand on Alpha-San B. So we're hoping that we can pull out a little bit more signal from that data set.
That's great, and I think it's quite a testament to persistence and trying to. And there's a lot of lessons in your story, I think, in terms of the importance of working the details and getting lots of data and comparing with other teams. So. Well, great. I know we've taken your time, and I appreciate particularly being on the East Coast, taking your time with us to talk for a little bit here. One last thing, which is big, but maybe nutshell, whatever, what's the future for you or exoplanet hunting or wherever you want to go?
So we're excited by the discoveries that we were just talking about, the discovery of this Earth-sized planet in the habitable zone around a star in the Kepler field, but we know that that star is 200 light years away. So we want to build new kinds of instruments that will have the sensitivity to detect Earth's inhabitable zones around our nearest neighbors. And we are in the process of designing something, I think, that's really quite different than any instrument that's been built before. And we're planning to put that instrument on the Discovery Channel telescope, which is a 4.3 meter telescope, so much larger, in Arizona. And we'll start surveying for Earth around Earth version 2.0 around our closest neighbors.
Great. Well, good luck to you. Best wishes on everything. And I know we'll still be in contact as Planetary Society is always interested in what you're doing. And I'll talk to you later. Thanks a lot.
Absolutely. My pleasure. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. I'll just switch this off here. I think there are a lot of important lessons from this, and that's why I think it's important to take a few minutes to hear real science in action. And it gets lost when you just hear the announcements, but pretty much everything we ever talk about in this class, and I show you the pretty results at the end, there's scientists like Debra and her graduate students and her undergraduates who are working detail after detail after detail, and they've been working for years and will keep working to improve that radial velocity precision. So how much wobble can they detect, getting it to smaller and smaller amounts? Also, you see the other parts of science in this story, competition and collaboration with other groups, sometimes the same group, that are studying what you're doing. It's also been a nice opportunity for the Planetary Society to help make a difference. In this study, we helped fund her fiber optic work that led to some different new improved back-end electronics on these telescopes. Our members helped fund more nights on the Alpha Centauri search and have made a difference. And finally, that science, whatever science you're doing, but including planetary or exoplanets, you really like to have that confirmation. So is there really a planet around Alpha Centauri B? Well, now it's not as clear with looking at a different data set, although all of this right now is right on the whether the finding or the not finding of that planet are right on the edge of detection limits. And that's why it's so important that Debra's group, and I know the Swiss group will, that uses HARPS, will be looking at next generations to take it to the next level when Alpha Centauri A and B separate again in their orbits and make it easier. Alpha Centauri A and B are the two main stars in the Alpha Centauri system, the two most sun-like stars. All right, we got a pile of questions. Let me go through those, and then we will go back and talk Kepler and transit technique. From Caleb Lindquist, is it possible our probes are incorrect about life on other planets? Yes. First of all, to be clear, we have never found any evidence of life on other planets. Are we looking? Yes. Are we looking for extraterrestrial intelligence? Yes. Have we found evidence of either? No. So if it's out there, yes. I wouldn't say it's incorrect, but we haven't gotten to where we've discovered either microbial life or more distant extraterrestrial life. Right now, no evidence. From Kryn, how do they detect if a planet they are seeing trillions of light years away has an atmosphere or has water? Hopefully some of that got described in the Spitzer Space Telescope video. First of all, not trillions of light years. And in fact, the farthest we look back, because the age of the universe is about 13.6, 13.7 billion years old, it's billions of light years is the most we look at, but I assume the point is looking really, really far away. It's tricky, and it's looking again at what we keep coming back to, which is spectra. So if you can see a spectral signature of something that indicates atmospheric gas, then you may be detecting it. But yeah, bottom line, it's hard, but interesting, and it's by doing things like they talked about of subtracting spectra of stars and their planets. That's something a lot of people are working on, trying to get to a better level of detection for the future. From Katie Gilliam, what is the significance of the stars named with HD and then numbers? That is from a star cataloging survey. To be honest, I forgot what HD stands for. I'm sure a quick Google search will tell you. But bottom line, it was a survey that identified lots and lots of stars. And so they just named them with HD representing the survey and then a number. Kryn, how do they know what the habitable zone is if the star system is very difficult to see? It is basically, you can figure out the temperature of the star by looking at its brightness and its color, particularly its color. We'll talk about that next week when we talk stars. If you can figure out the temperature, then you can figure out how far away from the star you need to be for liquid water to be stable on the surface of a body, although it always involves some assumptions. How much atmosphere are you assuming? Things like that. So it's not a crisp, clean, this is the habitable zone. It's kind of a fuzzy area. But that's the basic concept behind it. And then planet orbits, you can figure, derive from these techniques based upon how if you know how long it takes to go around the star and what the mass of the star is, then you know from the right equations, you know how far away the planet is from the star, at least what its semi-major axis is. From Joan Alay, what are some notable accomplishments or discoveries the Chiron has made? Sorry, didn't see that one when Debra was on the line. I didn't think I had any Debra-specific ones. Debra Fischer, their spectrometer is called Chiron that they use on the CTIO, the one we were talking about that looks at Alpha Centauri. And basically, one of the things is they don't see the planet around Alpha Centauri that was announced by the other group, but also they've just collected a lot of data for some other nearby stars, and we'll be collecting more, and hopefully we'll get big announcements out of it. From Kryn, why does it matter who finds data about any celestial object? Shouldn't the whole goal be simply the finding of knowledge to share with all humanity, no matter where they are geologically found? Do you mean which group finds the data as opposed to any other group? Yeah, the goal is to share it, and always the data is shared. But in a practical, one, people like to be the one to make the discovery. Two, if you're a scientist and you're trying to build your career and your future funding, it helps if you made the discovery. And that competition helps drive forward more discoveries. But all of these groups are publishing their results. And as you can see, even in this case of competition between these two groups, they have a lot of collaboration and sharing. So it's an interesting combination of collaboration and competition. And that one I already covered. Okay. Yes. All right. Now, let us fly through transit and some other techniques and some statistics. Let's look at the, wherever we are, let's look at the next image, full screen. So here's another one of these. This was just an example of an early Kepler find, 0.0456 AU, very close in, but now Neptune sized. Next image. Now let's look at some statistics of first of discovery. Next image, full screen. So this is but years, time is along this axis. You got 1990, 2000, and on this axis is the number of discoveries of planets that particular year. Notice there was nothing until, well, nothing that shows here. We think there was a planet discovered in 95, but basically things are really, really slow. 2000, now it's just all red, which is radial velocity technique making discoveries. Little bits of other techniques, and then we get into transits in green, and then this is really Kepler coming online. You have some from Corot and some even ground-based, but all of this in 2014, all that green, that's Kepler. So this is kind of everything we did before. This is Kepler. It's been a big leap forward. And also you see that everything is, almost everything you can see is green or red, which in this graph means radial velocity or transit method with a little bit of other stuff. Next image is from the Kepler team, the sizes of planets that are known. This was after they announced the confirmation of 1,200 planets in February of this year, and so they're showing off, the orange is just from that announcement. The blue is everything up until then. But let's take a look at basically these numbers. So the number of exoplanets, still most of what we know, what we see, 700 or so are Jupiter or larger. This is Neptune-sized, super-Earth size. They invented a size category to fit something between Neptune and Earth, so 1.25 to 2 Earth radii, and then we have Earth size down here. By the way, I talk about size, and I use it somewhat interchangeably, but what Kepler and transit methods really detect is diameter, size. What radial velocity detects is mass or something related to mass. But you, yeah. Next image. Now some scatter plots. Sticking with the, these are from the Exoplanet Archive, these plots, IPAC at Caltech. And this is, again, so they're keeping the same coding. Red is radial velocity, green is transit. Now we've got period of the orbit in days and the mass in Jupiter mass. So this is Jupiter mass. And this is period, but look, these periods are ridiculously short. This is one day to go around the parent star. So Earth's somewhere in here, and somewhere, what? It's a fraction of a Jupiter mass, so somewhere around here would be Earth. And so notice we got a big gap. This is before the announcement last week of the Earth size in close, although that one still is considerably shorter period. Well, what was it, 137 days. So you can see this is the spread, again, mostly transit, mostly radial velocity. The only people who've had time to observe things long enough to get 1,000-day periods is basically the ground-based radial velocity. That's why you see more clumping out here of those. They also see more, but the ones they can detect at those far distances are going to be the large mass, the 1 to 10 Jupiter masses. Next image. So here we've got what? Period, same axis down here, and eccentricity. So again, remember, zero is a circular orbit, and then when you get up here, it's really highly elliptical, really skinny or ellipse type orbit. See a lot of variability, a lot of circular. But again, my point here really is just there's a tremendous variability. Nearly our entire solar system, all the planets as currently defined, lie along that line. We're seeing planets of big sizes at all sorts of different eccentricities. So the rest of the or other solar systems, a lot of them look really different. Next image, And this is now out of date, but we'll just get ridiculous to fill it in more. These are Kepler discoveries where they've shown the size of the stars, the size of the planet they found around the stars. And this was the first many hundreds. And you see, again, what I'm really pointing out is diversity. Although a lot of stars similar in size because they've kind of focused on those, but different sizes, planets and stars, some different colors on the stars as well, indicating different temperatures. Now, we're going to take a look at another Kepler video, a quick video here. This is from many months or a year ago, something like that. And this was Kepler discovering multiple planets in a binary star system. So that gets complicated, depending on your binary star system, just like Alpha Centauri A and B is binary, but you can find stable ways to have planets. Let's take a look at that video.
NASA's Kepler mission has discovered the first system of multiple planets orbiting a pair of stars, or as astronomers call it, a circumbinary system. Located in the constellation of Cygnus, about 4,900 light-years from Earth, the discovery of Kepler-47 proves that more than one planet can form and persist while orbiting two stars. One star is similar to the Sun in size, but only 84% as bright. The second star is only one-third the size of the Sun and less than 1% as bright. The inner planet, Kepler-47b, is the smallest known in orbit around two stars. The outer planet, Kepler-47c, is a gaseous giant more than four times the size of Earth. Astrophysicists believe it might have an atmosphere blanketed with thick, bright water clouds. It orbits its host star every 303 days, placing it in the so-called habitable zone. This is the region in the planetary system where liquid water could exist on the surface of an orbiting planet. While not a world thought to be hospitable for life, Kepler-47c is the first known circumbinary planet found in the habitable zone of its stars, and it demonstrates the diversity of planetary systems in our galaxy. This discovery represents an important step for the Kepler mission in the effort to find Earth-sized planets in the habitable zone of their host stars.
You know what's fun about this, besides the profound nature of finding these other planets? It's being able to say habitable, habitable, habitable. Just try it. Try it just once. Habitable. Thank you. Okay. Now, back to diversity of planetary systems. That was one diversity. Let's look at the next image full screen. This is just a few sample systems that colleague Darren Ragazan has worked on. And this shows the period on a logarithmic scale of the orbit of the planet. 1 day, 10 days, 100 days. So again, the Earth would be off here somewhere. And these are all multi-planet systems observed by Kepler. Note some of them having up to at least six planets in them. They're color-coded, size-coded by variability of the planets. And again, the real point here is not that you memorize all of these, but just that you take in. Planetary systems are diverse. We had one solar system for all of humanity until we started to make these discoveries. Now we see systems of various scales and sizes, and this still, as noted by the question earlier, is showing a sampling effect. So it is by default showing things that have shorter periods and that are edge on and that are higher mass than they might otherwise be, particularly closer into the star. Higher size, so they're blocking out more light. But still, we see this tremendous diversity, even with those sampling effects. Okay, different technique, not as common, maybe in the future. Astrometry, the astrometric technique. So remember, our planets make the star wobble. But it's not actually wobbling, it's going around, going in its own little orbit, maybe like this, maybe like this. And the radial velocity is looking for, as we said, line of sight, radial motion in that orbit. Astrometry looks for the opposite, it looks for side-to-side motion. And so instead of looking for Doppler shift, you actually measure how much does the star move from one side of the planet, from how much does it move back and forth like this. Like all of these techniques, this is ridiculously hard. You were talking about measuring the tiniest fractions of degrees, which is why it hasn't been done very much successfully. one of these days we'll get a space-based mission that can take out the effects, not have the effects of the atmosphere and do this. But it is something to be aware of. Let's look at the next image. Full screen. There. So this is the concept that you have a planet that we're not seeing going around. It's causing the star to go around. And if you can measure where the star is on one side of its little orbit compared to the other side of its orbit, then you can determine how much it's being tugged, just like radial velocity, by its the unseen planet, drive the unseen planet. So that's the astrometric technique. Has been used, but only a tiny bit so far, but there have been proposals for crazed missions to measure exact positions of stars to do this. Next image is just another image of the same concept. So you're looking at the star wobbling due to the unseen planetary companion, and you're measuring how much it moves from one side to the other, and then from that you can derive information about the planet. Next image, let's go skip straight on to another really different technique, and this is gravitational lensing. And this is the only one of the techniques we've talked about so far that can really be used over much longer distances. The bad news is you can't particularly predict it, or even if you can, it's a very, very rare event. So the bottom line is, this requires a little bit more preamble. As our buddy, Al Einstein, told us in general relativity, gravity bends light. So if you put, if you're the observer, and you put a star or even a galaxy here, and another star or galaxy back here, and as it comes along, the light from that star will actually get bent around all sides of the intervening star or galaxy, and that, with just the right alignment, can act as a lensing effect. So it can actually magnify the object in the background, because now, just like a lens takes light and bends more of it than you would normally see to a point, this gravitational lensing will actually magnify what's going on, and you'll see something different. So now, back to this image full screen, that's the concept shown here, is gravitational lensing, where you have a star. In this case, we are talking stars. The lens star in the foreground, the source star in the background. This is a plot of the light you see as time passes, and over usually days or weeks, the source star is moving. Everyone's lining up. Everything's moving out there. It's just moving slowly. That's why it's so unlikely to get these lineups. But when you get the lineup, let's skip to this one. Then you've got the lens star in the middle and a source star back here. What we actually end up seeing, back here, is light being bent around from that star. And that increases. We see more light than we did when we just looked straight at the source star, because we're seeing it from all magnified. Lots of light that would have just gone off this way is actually being bent to our telescope. And so if you just have a lensing event for a star, you'll see the light grow and then the light fall as you're trying to look at that star because of whatever comes in front, another star. If you have a planet, it actually causes gets its own little lensing effect, and will appear as these little as a little blip, a little blip in your lensing, and so you actually can detect a planet. So that got a little muddled, but let's look at actual data. Let's look at the next image full screen. Yeah, and then this is an actual lensing event from a star called Ogle 2005 BLG390. You know it. You love it. And here is the lensing event. As we saw, light goes up because it's getting essentially magnified. We're seeing more of the light than we otherwise would. If there were no planet, it would just fall off like that. But we actually see this little deviation perturbation. They've blown it up here. And from that, you can actually deduce there's a planet there. And so a small number of the planets we found have been found using this technique. Problem is, once it's over, unlike these other techniques, you can't go back and keep observing it because you have to wait for one of these incredibly rare alignments to occur again. So really cool and good that you can see things much farther away than you can using these other techniques. Bad news is you don't have repeatability. You can't learn that much about it. Okay, we have 9 minutes for me to tell you about the entire origin of the solar system. And so we'll put some of the star formation off until next week, but let's take a quick conceptual view of origin of the solar system. So go ahead and put up the first image. A little hard to see, I know, but it gives the basic steps of formation. So you got a big ball of dust and gas, and that probably is sitting out there really low density, and then some shock wave comes through, for example, from a supernova explosion somewhere, kind of starts the gas moving towards each other. Once it get enough of it in kind of clumped, then self-gravity starts pulling all this stuff in gradually. And then as it pulls in, it starts to speed up. It also starts to flatten out. The whole thing, if you start out with just a little bit of spin in this original dust cloud, gas cloud, and it's almost impossible not to have some little bit of spin. Just like an ice skater who pulls in their arms and spins faster due to conservation of angular momentum, as this stuff pulls in, the cloud spins up. When the cloud spins up, you get the pizza dough effect. If you throw up a ball of pizza dough, it ends up getting flattened. Yeah, it's kind of different in the details, but it gives you the concept that it's the spinning, it's the angular momentum, it's the gravity that's flattening out the disk, at least towards the center. But you get more and more stuff falling inwards. Now, the key part is if it gets all the way and you get enough mass in the center, then you can form a star. Enough mass, and we'll talk about this in detail next week, where there's so much self-gravity in the middle of that it's squishing and starts to fuse hydrogen atoms together to form helium and releasing tremendous amounts of energy. That then starts pushing out solar wind and light, and that starts to clean out the debris, but what debris, so to speak, was out there has formed into planetesimals, protoplanets, and then eventually into planets. Let us review this in a different way. Next image, full screen. So while you've got that cloud coming together, you've got gas pressure keeping it out and gravitational force attempting to collapse it. You have that tug of war going on. Next image, so we're just kind of re-going through this with a different set of graphics. You got your spinning ball of gas and dust. Spinning ball starts to flatten out. Flattens out more, you form a star in the center. And let's look at the next image. And then we'll try to look at those videos if we have time. And so you got a proto-sun. A little tip for planetary scientists. For proto-planetary scientists, just add proto before a word to say one of those things that's not quite it yet, but is forming. So here's a proto-sun, here's some proto-planets in the solar nebula that is forming. This is looking at it from above. So the whole thing's spinning, just like, you know, we've ended up with planets spinning. You have some of the larger planets form in a similar process to the way the sun forms. You have where you can have gas and dust stable far enough from the star, as opposed to in closer work, it's blown outwards, then it can form planets like the gas giants, like Jupiter, like Saturn. When you're in the interior of the solar system, you tend to have formation of the things that don't get blown out as quickly by things like the solar wind, and that can stay solid, and so you don't get as many of the ices in close, but you get more ices farther out. And then you have the process called accretion. So buzzword to learn, accretion, where different particles, bits of sand-sized, dust-sized stuff, start running into each other and sticking. And then those run into others and they stick. And you accrete larger and larger bodies. Well, once you start accreting larger and larger bodies, they have more and more mass. Gravity is dependent upon mass. So the more mass you have, the more they're going to pull other stuff in. And sure, you're going to have violent collisions that are going to throw stuff out. Not all of it's going to fall back, but some of it is. And gradually you start to build protoplanets, or even a smaller version called planetesimals. and those come together, and eventually you end up sticking all the Play-Doh together into one big ball for each region of space, and that's how you end up with your planets, at least the rocky bodies. You've got this self-collapse gravitational mechanism happening in the outer solar system, where you end up with planets like Jupiter, like Saturn, that are basically forming their own miniature solar systems, similarly forming moons in similar ways to the way the rocky planets are forming inside. Let's look at the first the one video, the planetary gap video. If we can show that with my sound left up. So I was going to cover Kepler's laws. We will do that next week, but we will tidy off at least the gist of planetary formation, which I just gave you in like 3 minutes. So we can run that first video. So this is from a Spitzer Space Telescope artistic animation. So this is the concept of the early the solar nebula after the star forms. But you start to have sweeping up material while you're also blowing out the light gas, and if you can see, there's a planet body forming in there, and you still have the more gaseous stuff forming the gas giants farther out. Okay, we stop there. We will tidy a little on planet formation at the beginning of next lecture. We will talk stars, stellar processes, next lecture. I'm going to take a couple questions from Kryn. Why are there so many planets here in this solar system, yet we can only detect very few, if any, planets around other systems? It's purely detection. It's really hard to find planets around other stars. And we are finding places that we found 6-7 planet systems. If we had better detection methods, as we'll get, I'm sure we would find even more. Yeah, and was there another question there? Yeah, there is hiding. So next, there we go. From Burgundy, if our solar system was formed through a Big Bang, how come we have not seen or found evidence of other solar systems forming? First of all, you're mixing and matching terminology. Big Bang, that we'll talk about in two lectures, was formation of the universe. The planetary formation solar nebula that I just spewed out in the last few minutes was formation of our solar system. And we do. We see areas where, first of all, everything I showed you about other planets are other solar systems. So lots of data that there are other solar systems now. And we see ones that are where we see disks of gas and dust going around other stars that seem to be in the early stages of planet formation. I haven't focused on that as much, but we do have evidence. We do see that from various telescopes, particularly some of the space telescopes. Okay, so next we come back for a stellar lecture about stars. The sun is our sample star, how they work. We'll tidy off the lecture. We'll also talk about Kepler's laws at a basic level, so you get the hang of planetary motion just a wee bit more. In the meantime, you can learn more about Debra Fischer's exoplanet projects both through her Yale website, but also at planetary.org. If you check out some of my previous blogs, you'll find several about Debra's work. So think about all those exoplanets out there, and I will see you next time to talk about stars and stellar formation. Thanks to Debra Fischer for joining us today. Thank you, and good night.